Good morning, members of the board. Thank you for allowing us the opportunity to argue this important case. Part 1, Article 8 of the New Hampshire Constitution controls this case, as does Chapter 91A. Chapter 105, Section 13B, simply does not apply to the facts of this case. I think what's been lost in the arguments somewhat, in the briefing, etc., is what we're talking about. Talking about a list maintained by the Department of Justice and the Attorney General's office. We are not talking about police personnel files. We are not talking about police personnel files. The answer to all the questions relative to...
Doesn't the list collect information drawn from police personnel files?
And other sources, yes. Presumably. We don't really know that. That's why more transparency, not more concealment, is the answer to all of these questions. The public interest in knowing, as Attorney Bissonnette said, and by the way, I want to give a shout out to my co-counsel, Attorney Charles Douglas, who ably has assisted me throughout this process, as always. We're talking about a public record. We're talking about a public record that more transparency will make it a better public record for all the reasons outlined by Attorney Bissonnette. Public interest in knowing who the police officers are that are on this list is to me quite apparent, as has been pointed out in a department with whether it's a small or a large number of officers. When you're dealing with those officers as a citizen living in that town or driving through that town or visiting that town, and you're confronted or you're being arrested and prosecuted subsequently, you have the right to know whether this officer is on this list because he's been deemed, he or she has been deemed by the chief of police to have these trustworthiness and credibility issues. Now, this litigation has been pending for a number of years. Any officer who's been on that list 2004 until today has always had the right, and particularly has had the notice of the pendency of this action, and they could go to the Attorney General, and if not satisfied, they could go to Superior Court, as a number of officers have, and have been removed from the list.
Doesn't that impose a cost on the officers? Hire counsel, go to court, try and get themselves off the list?
Just like any other litigant. They have rights, and they may be successful in being removed or not, and the public has the right to know that. If they're removed from the list, it's just like a criminal defendant being acquitted.
Would you acknowledge that the public has an interest in having the list being confidential so that there's a fulsome investigation, knowing that it's protected from disclosure?
How would we ever know if that's the way things play out? So no, I don't agree with that at all. I trust the supervisors, the chiefs of police, to do the right thing. And when we have more transparency, we'll all know whether that's happening or not.
Do you think the creation of the list was somehow in part to protect a public interest?
Of course. Public interest in knowing that our police officers are doing the right thing on a day-to-day basis, as I should point out, 99% of them are. But they all get tainted by a secret list that says four police officers in town X have trustworthy and credibility issues. And I'm a citizen of that town. I don't know who those four police officers are. I don't know who the ones are that are doing the right thing each and every day, and we have the right to know that. The answer to all of the questions of this nature is always more transparency, more accountability, trust the public with that information and the right things happen. And with respect to the question about teachers, we're talking about police officers who carry a gun and a badge and who have the right to arrest us. It's a far different field of inquiry than any other public employee. It's a special trust. And with that trust comes special responsibility and the need for greater public scrutiny. They always have the right to be removed from the list if justice so requires. It's a wonderful thing, but this court has concluded that, and I guess the internal personnel practices argument is conceded, I think, not sure, but it sure should be, because internal personnel practices do not concern, as far as this court has stated, the performance of a particular employee.
Do you agree that the Governor's Commission report is part of the public record in this case?
I didn't know that it was.
I normally don't consider public information to be part of a record. Maybe I'm wrong.
Well, no, I do not believe it to be part of the record. And whatever happens down the road with respect to those recommendations and what the legislature does, I think is not, should not be of concern at this time. The time has come for this court to say, this document is a public record. It is not exempt by any of the exemptions that have been invoked, or, as this court has traditionally dealt with law enforcement records since 1978, we look to FOIA and we say, is there an exemption for this law enforcement record? And in this particular case, the answer is clearly no.
Red light is on.
I should say, I guess, when the yellow and red are both on, it's time for me to go.
Yeah, it's confusing, I know.
Thank you all very much.
Thank you very much. Mr. Will?
Thank you, Your Honor. A couple of points here. First of all, Attorney Bissonnette referred many times to, or analogized, I should say, many times to police officers on the DES as criminal defense, the same as criminal defense, Your Honor. And I would say that that is not a very apt analogy, because those police officers on the DES who are accused of or guilty of criminal conduct have been treated in the process, in the criminal process, just like every other criminal defendant. But there are many, many people on the DES, I suspect most, who have not been charged or convicted of criminal conduct. And so that really puts this list in a completely different place than the sort of the standard criminal process and events that criminal defendants go through along the way through the disposition of criminal cases.
They don't get appointed counsel to get off the list.
Correct, Your Honor. That is correct. And it is an imposition. It's a burden to have to file a lawsuit and try to get yourself off of this list. Second of all, with respect to the nature of the EES as police personnel file information, Attorney Sullivan said that the information comes from police personnel file, but then he loosely said from other places as well, and that we don't really know. And I would urge the court to keep in mind both the Foster memo and the McDonald memo, which make very clear that the information on the EES comes from a sustained finding by a police chief after whatever process occurs in the police department as to some sort of EES-worthy conduct on the part of an officer. And honestly, that theme goes all the way back to the Heat memo in 2004 as well. So it is not a sort of, it's the information from that comes to the list comes from the individual departments and in particular from sustained findings by chiefs after the whatever investigative processes they go through. I'd love to go on, but I can see that my red light also is on.
I'd love to have you both, all three of you, go on. I want to thank you for those excellent presentations and the case. is taken under advisement, of course, and the court is in recess.